adds one finite zero or pole such that system performance is improved. Okay, so it is a network which adds one finite zero or one finite pole such that system performance is improved. So here, by adding poles and zeros, we improve the performance of the system. So there are this is also one of the important topics from gate point of view, because most of the time a question of 2 marks or 3 marks, a question, one or two questions are have been asked on this topic. So and generally students skip this topic because it is at the end of the syllabus, so they generally think that it is not important. But I should tell you that it carries 1 or 2 marks, and the questions coming from this topic are very easy, so please don't skip this. So so as we have seen, compensators are nothing but they are the network which adds one finite pole or zero in the system, and the performance of the system is improved by that. There are 4 types of compensators. So there are 4 types of compensators. 4 types of compensators. They are lead compensator, lag compensator, lead lag compensator, and lag lead compensator. So these are the 4 types of compensators, and we will observe that in each of them we add a finite pole or a finite zero. So let us study them one by one. So let's start with lag compensator, lead compensator first. So let us study the definition of each and every, and how do they affect the system. So first is lead compensator. So a lead compensator is called so because when a sinusoidal input is applied to a network, it produces sinusoidal output, sinusoidal steady state output by adding a phase lead with respect to input. Then the compensator is called a lead compensator. So if I apply sinusoidal input to a system, we have already seen this, the concept of sinusoidal output. So whenever I apply sinusoidal input to a system, to an LTI system, suppose this is my LTI system, and if I apply sinusoidal input to this, so I'll get the sinusoidal output. So sinusoidal input will give me sinusoidal output, but there will be a phase difference and magnitude difference. That is, whatever input, whatever magnitude and phase input is having, the output will have a different magnitude and phase. Now, if the phase of the output is leading the phase of input, then that particular compensator is called as a lead compensator. That means here the output will be ahead of the input in terms of phase. So it will have a lead phase, phase lead. and therefore these particular type of compensators are called as lead compensators. Now, what are the advantages of lead compensator? So lead compensator, it speeds up the transient response. This is very important. So lead compensator speeds up the transient response. So this is the advantage of lead compensator. Fine. Now, next we'll see the lag compensator. We'll study them in detail. Just I'm giving you the brief overview of the different types of compensators. So in this, as we have seen in lead compensator, that if the output will be leading the input, then in that particular compensator will be called as a lead compensator. Now, when the output is lagging behind the input, that particular compensator is called as lag compensator. So if the steady state output of the system has a phase lag, then the compensator is called lag compensator. So if there is a phase lag, then that particular system is called as phase lag compensator. Now, as we have seen, lead compensator, it improves the transient response. It speeds up the transient response. Similarly, the lag compensator affects the steady state behavior. So, lag compensator improves the steady state behavior and it does not affect the transient response. So what we have seen till now is lead compensator, it will have an output which is leading the input and it will affect the transient response. Similarly, lag compensator, the output of the system will have a phase lag with respect to the input and it improves the steady state behavior. It does not affect the transient response at all. Next we have lead lag compensator. Okay, first let me introduce lag lead compensator, because lag lead compensator have better advantages when compared to the lead lag compensator. Now in this compensator, both phase lead and phase lag occurs, but in different frequency regions. So phase lead and phase lag both occurs in different frequency regions. So therefore it is called as lag lead compensator. Now, so phase lag, this occurs at low frequency. This occurs at low frequency, whereas phase lead, it occurs at high frequency. And the lead lag compensator will be just reverse of this. There also we will have phase lead as well as phase lag, but phase lead will be at the low frequencies and phase lag will be at the higher frequencies. Now this lag lead compensator, it improves both the steady state as well as transient performance. So it improves both the steady state and transient response. The last type of compensator is lead lag. As far as lead lag compensator is concerned, they are not preferred because they produce attenuation in the system. they are similar to what we have studied in lag lead, what we have seen in lag lead, but they are not preferred because they are not preferred because they produce attenuation in the system. So therefore they are not preferred. Now, what do we do in lead compensator? Let us observe the S-plane diagrams. So S-plane diagrams, or it is pole zero plot, pole zero diagram. Pole zero diagram. So we'll see the pole zero diagram of each and every compensator. Now, if you observe the lead compensator, its pole zero diagram is like this. That means a zero is near to the imaginary axis. We add a pole as well as a zero, but the added zero is nearer to the imaginary axis. So this is the pole zero diagram of lead compensator. Lag compensator is just reverse of what lead compensator. So here a pole will be added near to the imaginary axis, whereas a zero will be added . So these are the pole zero diagrams of lead compensator and lag compensator. Now, lead lag compensator. So lead lag compensator will have a pole zero diagram with lead first. That is, whatever the lead compensator has, the type of pole zero diagram lead compensator has, that will come first, and then we will have the pole zero diagram of lag compensator. Now in lead compensator, we have seen that a zero appears near the imaginary axis. So you will have zero first and then a pole. For lag compensator, we have seen there is a pole first and then a zero. So this is the characteristics of lead compensator and this is the characteristics of a lag compensator. So this is lead lag compensator. So this is pole zero diagram of lead lag compensator. Next, lag lead compensator. So lag lead compensator will be just reverse of . So in lag lead compensator, we will have the characteristics of lag compensator first and then the lead compensator. Now for lag compensator, we have a pole first and then a zero. Similarly for lead compensator, we have a zero first and then a pole. So this is lag lead compensator. So these are the pole zero diagrams of lag lead compensator. So here what we can understand is, we have basically two types of compensator, and by joining them we are making two more types of compensators. So if we study about the lead compensator and lag compensator, we can easily study about the lead lag compensator and lag lead compensators. Now these particular compensators, they behave like filters. So we can use the compensator like filters. So here I'll introduce just that what kind of filter, which type of compensator can be used as what type of filter. Later when we will study about, in detail about them, we'll observe that whatever we have seen now will be true there. So I'll make a table here. So their first column contains compensator, then I have the type of filter it is acting, and we'll see whether we are adding pole zero, we are adding a pole or zero first. Okay. Now, so if we observe the lead compensator, it acts as a high pass filter. It acts as an high pass filter. So the characteristics of high pass filter are like this. And here we have zero. So we are adding a zero first. So because of that, we'll see, because of that we are getting this kind of characteristics. Now, next we will see the lag compensator. For lag compensator, the filter is, it acts as low pass filter, right? Low pass filter, and its characteristics are something like this. Here we add pole first. we also know that from Bode plot, then whenever we add a zero, it gives us a positive angle. The angle given by a zero is positive, whereas a pole gives a negative angle. Next. Now, if we observe the lead lag compensator, so lead lag compensator acts as band pass filter. So this is band pass filter. And finally, here we'll study about this in detail later. And finally, the lag lead compensator, it acts as a band stop filter. It acts as a band stop filter. Like this. So these are the four types of compensators and the type of filter, the type of filter which can be used. Now, there are few very important formulas and we do not need the derivations. So let me give you the formulas for them. So first of all, the transfer function. So the transfer function for lag or lead compensator, it is very similar. So V naught by Vi is the transfer function and it is equal to 1 plus tau s by 1 plus alpha tau s. This is in general a transfer function for both lead compensator as well as lag compensator. Now when alpha is less than 1, it acts as a lead compensator. And when alpha is greater than 1, it acts as a lag compensator. So what we, if you observe the transfer function, it is nothing but we are adding a finite pole and a finite zero. The pole location is s equal to minus 1 by alpha tau. This is my pole and zero is added at minus 1 by tau. So as we have stated in the beginning itself, that compensator are the networks which add a finite pole or a finite zero in the network. And we improve the performance of the behavior. So that's what we have done here. If you observe the transfer function, we have added a pole as well as a zero. Now, alpha greater than 1. That means if alpha is greater than 1, then the pole value will be less than the zero value. Pole value will be less than the zero value. That means, so for lag compensator, we have already seen that we are adding a pole near to the imaginary axis. And if alpha is less than 1, then the pole value will be greater than the zero value. So that means, as we have seen the pole zero diagram of all the compensators, we have seen that for lead compensator, what we do? For lead compensator, we add a zero near to the imaginary axis, whereas for a lag compensator, we add a pole to near to the imaginary axis. And that's what we are doing here. By changing the value of alpha, we are changing the location of pole. Once we are bringing the pole nearer to the imaginary axis by making alpha greater than 1, and once what we are doing, we are taking it away from the imaginary axis by making alpha less than 1. So in this way, we vary the position of poles and zeros in a compensator. Now, there are few important formulas and they are common for both lead compensator and lag compensator and they can be used at the examination. So from gate point of view, these formulas are very important and the question has already been asked on this. So the formulas are, I'll just write down those formulas. Later when we study in detail about them, then you will understand that yes, those formulas are correct. Now, so first, the first formula is about the maximum frequency, omega max. That means at which frequency the magnitude is maximum. So for lead or lag, it is same. So omega max for lead or lag, it is 1 by tau into under root alpha. This is omega max for lead or lag compensator. Next, we will see the magnitude. So magnitude at omega max. So this frequency is the frequency at which maximum phase occurs. And the magnitude at omega max is 10 log 1 by alpha. Next, phi max. So phi max will occur for lead compensator and phi min will occur for lag compensator. So phi max is sine inverse of 1 minus alpha by 1 plus alpha, as alpha is less than 1 for lead compensator, and it is sine inverse of alpha minus 1 by alpha plus 1 as alpha is greater than 1. So this is phi max and phi min formulas. So these formulas are very important from gate exam point of view. So it is better if students can remember these formulas. Okay, now let us study about these circuits in detail. So let me study about the lead compensator and lag compensator simultaneously. So what I'll do is I'll make a table, and on one side of it I'll explain you the lead compensator, and on the other side I'll explain you the lag compensator. So let me divide the page into two parts. One side I'll start with lead compensator, and the other side will cover lag compensator. Now for lead compensator, the circuit is something like this. So this is Vi, this is V0. We have R2 here, R1 here, and C1 here. Now, if we calculate the transfer function of this system, so I will get V0 of S by Vi of S is equal to, so it's R2 divided by its voltage across R2. So I can use the concept of voltage division principle. So R2 divided by its R1 divided by 1 plus S R1 C1, which is the equivalent impedance of R1 in parallel with C1, and plus R2. So this is the transfer function V0 of S by Vi of S. Now if you solve this, you will get R2 into, I'll take the LCM here, so I'll get R2 into S C1 R1 plus 1 divided by, I'll get in the denominator R1 plus R2 into S C1 R1 plus 1. And this can be further written as 1 plus S C1 R1 divided by R1 plus R2 in plus S C1 R1 R2. Now, here I can further write down this as R2 by, I'll take R1 plus R2 common here. So I'll get 1 plus S C1 R1 divided by 1 plus S C1 R1 R2 divided by R1 plus R2. So this is the transfer function for lead compensator. Now if you observe here, this is we have a finite pole as well as a finite zero here. Now, the time constant of RC circuit is R into C. We know this. So, R1 C1 is nothing but the time constant of the resistor in parallel with capacitor. So, we have a resistor in parallel with capacitor, and the time constant of this will be R1 into C1. So, I'll assume that as tau. So, I'll replace that by tau. So, here I'll replace tau by, so I'll replace R1 C1 by tau. Also, I'll consider alpha. So alpha here is R2 divided by R1 plus R2. So this will be alpha into 1 plus S C1 R1 divided by 1 plus S. So C1 R1 is tau here. So sorry, let me replace this also with tau. So this is 1 plus S tau, and here I'll get S tau into alpha also, because R2 by R1 plus R2 is assumed to be alpha. So if you observe this transfer function now, it is in the standard form except this alpha. There is an extra alpha over here, and here the if you observe the alpha, alpha is less than 1 because it is R2 by R1 plus R2. So it is always less than 1. So whatever we have said in the beginning, that lead compensator, it adds a finite pole as well as a finite zero, and a finite zero is nearer to the imaginary axis. And that is true here because alpha is less than 1. So what we are doing is we are adding a pole as well as we are adding a zero, and pole is and zero is nearer to the imaginary axis. Now next, parallelly we will study the lag compensator here. So the lag compensator, the schematic of lag compensator is shown below. So it's Vi, V output. Here I have R1, R2 and C2. Now, again, if I find the transfer function of this, so V0 of S by Vi of S is equal to, it's R2 plus 1 by S C2 divided by R1 plus R2 plus 1 by S C2. Now, if I take the LCM of this, I'll get 1 plus S C2 R2 divided by 1 plus R1 plus R2 by R2 into S C2 R2. Now, this is the transfer function. And in this, again, if you observe C2 R2, it is the time constant. And here I'll consider R1 plus R2 by R2 as alpha. So I'll consider tau is equal to C2 R2, R2 C2, and alpha is equal to R1 plus R2 by R2. So therefore, I'll get V0 of S by Vi of S is equal to 1 plus S tau 2. Let me consider this as tau 2. So S tau 2 divided by 1 plus alpha tau 2 into S, whatever. Here we observe that alpha is greater than 1, and again we are adding a pole and a zero in the transfer function. Again here, since alpha is greater than 1, therefore we are adding a finite pole nearer to the imaginary axis and a finite zero which is away from the pole. Okay, so in this way, we have proved whatever we have said till now about lead and lag compensator. We have seen their transfer functions and we have seen the network which can be used as a lead compensator and a lag compensator. Now here, a point to discuss was about alpha. I said that there is an extra alpha term, and alpha is less than 1 in this case. So what is happening if alpha is less than 1, then it produces attenuation in the system. So in order to remove this, what we do is we use an amplifier. So the alpha which is generating, there is an extra alpha which is generated over here. To remove that alpha, what we are doing is we are just adding a amplifier here. So this is an amplifier whose gain will be 1 by alpha, and output will be V0 dash. Now suppose earlier the output was V0 and the output is V0 dash from the amplifier. So in this way, what we have done is the alpha term will be removed in this amplifier and we will get the output without the alpha term included in that. So in this way, we have designed a lead compensator. Now let me draw the Bode plot of them. I'll draw the Bode plot, and then from the Bode plot, it will be very much clear that the lead compensator are used as high pass filter, whereas the lag compensator are used as a low pass filter. So let me use the transfer function and draw the Bode plot. So again, let me continue that partition. So on one side, I'll draw the Bode plot for lead compensator, and on the other hand, I'll draw the Bode plot for a lag compensator. So a Bode plot, as we have already seen, that it contains two plots. One is magnitude plot and the other one is a phase plot. Now, here what we are doing, we are adding a pole and a zero, and pole is added and a zero is added nearer to the imaginary axis. So here we take the corner frequencies, and the corner frequency will be 1 by tau and 1 by alpha tau. We know that the magnitude of poles and zeros are nothing but the corner frequencies, and this corner frequencies will be same for phase plot also. So this is my magnitude plot, magnitude in dB, and here I'll draw phase phi. Now what will happen, we are adding a zero at 1 by tau. So zero means it introduces a slope of plus 20 dB per decade. So 1 by tau will have a zero slope up to 1 by tau, and for one great omega greater than 1 by tau, the slope will be plus 20 dB per decade. So it will be something like this. Next, at 1 by alpha tau, what we are doing? We are adding a pole. So before 1 by alpha tau, it will produce a zero slope, but after 1 by alpha tau, it will produce a slope of minus 20 dB per decade. Already we have a slope of plus 20 dB per decade here. So if we add a minus 20 dB per decade, it will cancel it and we will get a zero slope. So this is the magnitude plot of phase lead compensator. Next, here what will happen now? So we have seen that for a finite zero, before 1 by tau, it gives an angle of 0 degree, and afterward it will give me an angle of plus 90 degrees. So it will give me an angle of plus 90 degrees up to the next pole. At 1 by alpha tau, we have a pole now. Earlier at 1 by tau, we have a 0, and 0 gives me an angle of plus 90 degree. So here at 1 by alpha tau, we are adding a pole, and pole will give me an angle of minus 90 degrees. So this will cancel out this, and here we'll end up with 0 degrees angle. So this is the asymptotic plot. To draw the exact plot, what we have done earlier, just draw a line from the midpoints. So this is the exact phase plot. What we observe here is that at a frequency we have maximum phase. At a particular frequency, which is called as omega max, omega m, let me consider it as omega max, we are getting a maximum phase. So this phase is maximum, and this is given by the formula which we have already studied earlier. It's sine inverse 1 minus alpha by sine inverse 1 plus alpha. So in this way, whatever we have studied till now was exactly correct. Now at this particular frequency, there is a important thing here, this omega max is nothing but the geometric mean of these two corner frequencies. The two corner frequencies are 1 by tau and 1 by alpha tau. So the omega max is nothing but it is geometric mean of 1 by tau and 1 by alpha tau. So it comes out to be 1 by tau into under root alpha. So this is the value of omega max, and at this particular omega max, the value of phi max will be sine inverse of 1 minus alpha by 1 plus alpha. So this is very important, that the omega max is nothing but the geometric mean of the two corner frequencies. Now if you observe the magnitude plot, we can see that this particular lead compensator, it is acting as a high pass filter. It is the characteristic similar to a high pass filter. So therefore, the thing which we had suggested earlier in the beginning, I have told you that the lead compensator will act as an high pass filter. I am proving that here. So it is proved that the lead compensator can act as an high pass filter. And it is why this is happening, because what is happening, we are adding a zero first, and zero introduces an angle of plus 90 degrees, and it introduces a slope of plus 20 dB per decade. For this reason, it is acting as a high pass filter. Similarly, if I draw the magnitude and phase plot of lag compensator, so what will I observe here? That again, here I'll add a pole first. So the pole will be at 1 by alpha tau and 0 will be at 1 by tau. So these are the two corner frequencies. Now at 1 by alpha tau, what we are doing? We are adding a pole. So pole will give me an angle of a slope of minus 20 dB per decade. So it will give me a slope of minus 20 dB per decade. Then at 1 by tau, what I am doing? I am adding a 0. And 0 will give me a slope of plus 20 dB per decade. So this will be a straight line again. So in this way, this is the magnitude plot of. So this is magnitude in dB. So this is magnitude plot of lag compensator. Okay. Next, if we draw the phase plot, we observe that at omega equal to 1 by alpha tau, we will add an angle of, we'll get an angle of minus 90 degrees. It will be continued till the 0, 1 by tau, and at 0 we'll get an angle of plus 90 dB per decade. So this way. So to draw the exact plot, just touch the midpoints and draw a curve. So this is omega m again. This is omega minimum. So at this particular frequency, what is happening? The phase is minimum in this case. So this is phase minimum, phi minimum, and it occurs at omega m. So in general, I am considering this as omega m. So that's why I should have written it omega m only. It represents both omega max as well as omega mean, because their values will be same. Again, here the omega m will be the geometric mean of omega c1 and omega c2. What is omega c1 here? 1 by alpha tau, and omega c2 is 1 by tau. So therefore it will be again 1 by tau into under root of alpha. Phi min will be same sine inverse of alpha minus 1 by alpha plus 1. And if you observe the Bode plot, this is actually, if you shift it, you'll observe that it is a low pass filter. So it is acting like a low pass filter. So we have seen the Bode plot of both lead compensator and lag compensator. It is very important, and all the formulas which we had just written in the beginning have been derived here, have been proved over here. Next, about lead lag and lag lead compensator, just we'll study them quickly. So lag compensator on one hand, and the other hand we'll have lag lead compensator. So here what we will do, first we will have the characteristics of lead compensator. So resistor in parallel with a capacitor, and here we have resistor in series with a capacitor, this way. So therefore we have R1 here and C1 here, R2 here and C2 here. So this will give me the characteristics of lead compensator, and this will give me the characteristics of a lag compensator. This is V2, this is V1. Similarly, if you draw the diagram for lag lead compensator, we have a resistor and a capacitor here, and here we will have a resistor in parallel with capacitor. So this is R2 C2. I'll consider them as R2 C2 itself, and this is R1 C1. So this is again lag compensator, and this is again lead compensator. Now the transfer function can be directly written. Here tau 1 is R1 C1, which is for lead compensator. So let me consider this. Okay, tau 1 is for lead compensator, and tau 2 is for lag compensator, which is R2 into C2. So the transfer function, so if I draw the S plane, the pole zero diagram of this, what we are doing is we have this is lead lag compensator. So the first I should have lead compensator. So lead compensator I have a zero first and a pole, then a pole and a zero. Now the pole value will be, the zero value will be minus 1 by tau for this, and this will be 1 by alpha tau 1. So alpha 1 tau 1. And for this, what will I do? I'll consider minus 1 by alpha 2 tau 2 and minus 1 by tau 2. So this is for lead compensator and this is for lag compensator. So in this way we get that pole zero diagram for lead lag compensator. So if I write the transfer function of this, so transfer function will be V naught of S by Vi of S is equal to 1 plus tau 1 S divided by 1 plus alpha 1 tau 1 into S, where alpha 1 will be less than 1. And simultaneously with this, we have the lag compensator. So 1 plus tau 2 S by 1 plus alpha 2 tau 2 into S. So alpha 1 is less than 1, whereas alpha 2 is greater than 1. Now, if I draw the Bode plot for this, so Bode plot again will contain two plots. So first we have the characteristics of lead compensator. So I have here minus 1 by tau 1, minus 1 by alpha 1 tau 1. Here I have minus 1 by alpha 2 tau 2, and here I have minus 1 by tau 2. So these are the four corner frequencies. Actually, I should not have taken minus here, because they are all corner frequencies, the Bode plot. So therefore, these are the four corner frequencies. Now, what we are doing at 1 by tau, we are adding a 0 first. So 0 will give me a slope of plus 20 dB per decade. Then I am adding a pole at my 1 by alpha 1 tau 1. So it will give me a slope of minus 20 dB per decade. So the overall slope will become 0. Now again at 1 by alpha 2 tau 2, what we are doing? We are adding a pole again. So pole will give me an angle of minus 20 dB per decade. And finally, we are adding a 0. So it will give me a slope of plus 20 dB per decade. So the overall slope will be 0. So in this way, this is the magnitude plot of lead lag compensator. Now if I draw the phase plot, this is versus omega. So if I draw the phase plot, so we are adding a 0 first. So 0 will give me a slope of plus 90 dB per decade, plus 90 degrees. Then I'll get a minus 90 degrees, so it will become 0. Then here I'll get a minus 90 degrees and a plus 90 degrees. So this is the overall phase plot of the lead lag compensator. If I draw the actual plot, it will be like this. So these are the corner frequencies. So if you observe the magnitude plot, we observe that it is the characteristics of a band pass filter. Similarly, if we carry out the same kind of analysis for lag lead compensator also, so the pole zero diagram will be, here we have lag first and then lead. So I'll get a pole first, then a zero, then a zero, then a pole. So pole will, the value of pole will be minus 1 by alpha 2 tau 2, and it will be minus 1 by tau 2. It is because of the lag compensator, and for lag compensator we have given the values of R2 C2. For lead compensator, we have minus 1 by tau 1 first and then minus 1 by alpha 1 tau 1. So this is the pole zero diagram of lag lead compensator. Next, if I write the transfer function out of this, so it's V naught of S by Vi of S, which is equal to, so here I'll get 1 plus tau 2 S by 1 plus s divided by 1 plus alpha 1 tau 1 s. So this is the transfer function. Now if I draw the Bode plot out of this, so Bode plot will have, again I have the four corner frequencies. The first corner frequency is 1 by alpha 2 tau 2, next 1 by tau 2, 1 by tau 1, and 1 by alpha 1 tau 1. So what we are doing is, first we are adding a pole at this 1 by alpha tau 2. So it will give me a slope of minus 20 dB per decade. Then at 1 by tau 2, I'll add a 0. So it will give me a slope of plus 20 dB per decade. Then again, minus 20 dB per decade. And then plus 20 dB per decade. So this is the phase magnitude plot of a band stop filter. This is the transfer function of a band stop filter. Now, if I draw the phase plot will be, so at 1 by alpha 2 tau 2, what we are doing? We are adding a pole. So pole will give me an angle of minus 90 degrees. Then here I have plus 90 degrees, 0. Here plus 90 degree again. And finally, 0. So these are the, and if I draw the angles, if I draw the exact plot, so the exact plot will look like this. So this is the overall analysis of, so here again you observe that we have omega m1, we have two frequencies here, omega m1 and omega m2, here also omega m1 and omega m2. So at omega m1, what is happening here? We have phase lead. So we have lead here and we have lag here. Similarly, we have lag here and a lead here. So what is happening at lower frequencies? We are getting a lead compensator, and at higher frequencies we are getting a lag behavior, lag nature in lead lag compensator, and the reverse in lag lead compensator. So therefore the entire analysis in the is being carried out for all the four types of compensators, and we have seen that we can use them as four types of filters. So from exam point of view, this is very important. So it's a small topic, very easy, and if you get a question, it is very easy to answer. Next, we will study the topic, last topic of our syllabus, and that is controllers. This is also a small topic, and it may all and there may be a question of 1 or 2 marks from this. So the last topic of control system is about controllers. Now what are controllers? Again, controller is a device which is used to control steady state and transient response as per requirement. These are very similar to compensators. Now if you observe that diagram, the block diagram, so the block diagram of controller will be, for closed loop transfer function, what do we have? We have, this is the transfer function of system, which is G of S. We have feedback here. And C of S is the output over here. R of S is the input. Now, this is the transfer function of controller, which is denoted by GC of S. So this is the block diagram of a controller. So we introduce a controller along with the open loop transfer function so that we can control the steady state or transient response. So a controller, what is controller? A controller is a device. A controller is a device which is used to control, steady state and particular requirement. Now, we'll study the different types of controller. First type of controller is a P controller. Means proportional controller. So, what does a proportional controller do? So, the proportional controller is used to change the transient response. So, it is used to change transient response. And what are transient response? So, transient response we have already seen transient response is nothing but the TR, that is rise time, then we have delay time, we have peak time, all those are transient responses. So they can be controlled by using proportional controller, and all of them depends on zeta and omega n, that is the damping factor and the natural frequency. So this type of controllers are used to change the transient response as per requirement. Now, the transfer function of a proportional controller is, transfer function of a P controller is Kp. So, Kp is the transfer function of P controller. So, here this block will be replaced by Kp. So, Gc of S is Kp here. Now, let me consider an example and explain how it will change the transient response as per our requirement. So let me consider an example. So let G of S, that is open loop transfer function, as 1 by S into S plus 10. So the closed loop transfer function of this will be, so if I do not apply this controller first, without controller, so whatever I'm doing is this without controller. So this is without controller. So without controller, the closed loop transfer function will be 1 by S square plus 10S plus 1. So if we compare this with the standard transfer function, standard second order transfer function, we get omega n equal to 1 and zeta is equal to 5. And zeta equal to 5 implies it is an overdamped system. Now, if I introduce the controller, so with controller, the G of S is given by Kp by S into S plus 10. So this is the transfer function with controller. Now, in this case, the closed loop transfer function C of S by R of S is given by Kp by S square plus 10S plus Kp. Now, if my Kp is 100, then omega n will be 10 and zeta is 0.5. If Kp is 100. And if Kp is 25, then omega n will be 5 and zeta will be equal to 1. Zeta equal to 0.5 means it is underdamped system, and zeta equal to 1 means it is critically damped system. So what do we observe here? That by varying the value of K, we can get the desired system. Whatever type of system we require, we can get that by varying the value of Kp. But without controller, it was not possible. So what do we understand here? That the proportional controller, it can control the transient response in desired manner by varying the value of omega n and zeta. Next, the second type of controller is I controller. Integral controller. So, what is the purpose of integral controller? First, let me write the purpose. So, the purpose of K controller was it could it could vary the transient response in desired fashion. Now the purpose of this is it is to decrease steady state error, ESS. So we can decrease ESS by using iController. And the transfer function of this is KI by S. This is the transfer function of an iController. So if you observe the transfer function, what we are doing? We are adding a pole at origin. And whenever we add the pole, what happens? The order of the system is changed, or type of the system is changed. And whenever type of system is increased, whenever we increase the type of system, the steady state error decreases. So what we are doing is by introducing iController, we are increasing the type. So type is increased. Type of the system is increased, which implies that the steady state error ESS will decrease. Let us consider an example. Again, the similar example what we have seen earlier. So without a controller, we have considered that G of S is equal to 1 by S into S plus 10. This is the transfer function. The type of the system is 1. Type is 1. And if we take the characteristic equation, so characteristic equation is S square plus 10S plus 1 equal to 0. Now with controller, GC of S will become, so this is without controller. So with controller, this will become 1 by S square into S plus 10. Type becomes 2. And the characteristic equation will be S cube plus 10S square plus 1 plus KI. Sorry, here we have KI. So KI equal to 0. If you observe the two characteristic equations, the first characteristic equation will always give you a stable system. This will always implies a stable system. Whereas if you observe the second characteristic equation, here the S power 1 term is missing. And therefore this will always result you an unstable system. So what is happening here? By introducing iController, what we are doing? We are increasing the type of the system. But increasing the type of the system will reduce the steady state error. Also, it makes a stable system as unstable. So this is the disadvantage of iController. Next, we'll study the derivative controller, that is dcontroller. So what will happen with the dcontroller? So dcontroller will improve the stability. So the purpose of dcontroller is to improve the stability. It improves the stability. Now the transfer function of this is KD into S. So what is happening? Dcontroller is adding a zero at origin, and the type of the system is decreased here. So therefore the system becomes stable. Also, since we are reducing the type, so reducing type will increase the steady state error, because for higher order system, higher type systems, the steady state error is less. So what we are doing here is we are introducing a zero at origin. So we are introducing a zero at origin, and introduction of that zero is making a system stable, but also it is reducing the type of system. So stability is increased. Stability is increased, but the ESS, it increases. In the previous case, what was happening? The steady state error was decreasing, but the stable system was becoming an unstable. Let us consider the same example again. So without controller, if I consider G of S is equal to 1 by S square into S plus 10. This is without controller. Then this is a type 2 system. Type of the system is 2. and the characteristic equation of this system is